And today we have with us Mr. Atul Bhole, who's the Vice President Investments at DSP Mutual Fund. He will discuss his thoughts on the budget, Union Budget 2021 today with us. To give a brief introduction to him, he has been with DSP since 2016. And prior to that, he's had 10 years work experience with Tata AMC. Currently, he manages around 13,000 crores. And the schemes managed by him are the DSP FlexiCap, DSP Equity and Bond Fund, and the Dynamic Asset Allocation Fund. The agenda for the meeting today is to understand Mr. Atul's overall view on the Union Budget and subsequent market outlook. Post that, we will move on to some specific questions regarding the implications of the budget on some various sectors. Overall view on the budget, and what do you think the subsequent market outlook will be post this?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Anushi. Thanks a lot for that introduction. So we'll start with the budget outlook. I think as by now everybody is aware that the budget was good, and I think the best part of the budget that there was nothing in the budget. I mean, people were fearing some kind of a COVID cess on the HNIs or high income category, or maybe increase in excise for petrol or diesel, or maybe long-term capital gain, short-term capital gain, etc., etc. So the best part of the budget is there is no change in the taxation, and I think that's what market is enjoying or rejoicing. And if you actually see 10-15 days before budget, I mean from that time onward, market had corrected by 1500 point, and market was nervous because of these fears were there, or the concerns were there. And because these concerns sort of didn't materialize, market quickly bounced back from those oversold levels maybe. So I think the biggest takeout from the budget is, I think government is sticking to stability and the transparency, and I think market is rewarding for that. The other good part of the budget is basically some corporation like Food Corporation of India was borrowing from the market, and it was not coming on the Union Budget till now. But this year, government has given grant to FCI, and those borrowing of FCIs in a way will be accounted into the Union Budget. So to that extent, the numbers we are seeing around fiscal deficit and the borrowing numbers, they are a lot more credible than the previous 2-3 years, because what was used to happen is government used to borrow one number, and apart from that, the corporations like Food Corporation and the others like IRFC, they used to borrow outside the budget. So though we were getting some number of the budget, the overall number used to be bigger than that. So I think by including the FCI borrowings in the Union Budget, the transparency or the credibility of the budget has gone up a lot. So I think that is one big and if in the following years government continue with this path of making the budget and the making the government finances transparent, I think it will be again be taken very positively by the market as well as international community and credit rating agency. I would say that this may be one of the starting step in terms of including the government bonds into the global bond indices. I think we are now fifth largest economy in the world. You know how the macro parameters of India has behaved in last 1 year, particularly during the COVID year. The rupee was very stable, which is the best indicator of how the economy is doing. So rupee was stable. Asset quality actually improved during the last 1 year. Also, we got a lot of foreign inflows in last year. So all things are falling in place for India. And I think that's how government is possibly planning for inclusion of Indian bonds into the global bond indices. So what will happen if, as and when, maybe next 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, as and when these bonds gets included in the global indices, lot of foreign money will come into India into these bonds, because you know $18 trillion of assets are earning negative interest rates, and Indian government is still paying 6% or whatever that 6.5% in terms of G-Sec return. I think huge money will come to India once that happens, and it will be again very good for the economy as a whole, because cost of capital will go down. So I think though now for now we are looking at this FCI borrowing coming on the union budget as a positive. It is obviously positive, but I think it is a starting step in terms of including these bonds into global bond indices. So from that perspective, it is even better. And now, lastly, coming to that whatever that noise about infra capex increase and all, so I think that is good thing. There were concerns that government will sort of go for fiscal consolidation and the spending will be limited, etc. I think at this point of time, economy needed continuous spending because economy is still recovering. It is not that we have fully recovered. And government continue with that spending pattern. Again, market was expecting fiscal deficit target of 5.5, 5.8, but government went ahead with 6.8 kind of fiscal deficit target, and they are spending, and they are going to spend into the productive way of spending. It is not just like putting out money into the people's hand. It is going into infrastructure, and it will have better multiplier effect. So whenever government spends on asset creation or infrastructure, lot of people will get employment, lot of companies will get contracts, cement and steel and everything will be required. So it will have a lot of multiplier effect. And again, obviously that is good for the country as a whole. As usual, we have to see actually how much will get spent, how much will get postponed to next year and all, because 5 year, 10 year, 15 year experience is that a lot of big announcement happen, but the projects takes place at their own sweet pace. So I think directionally it is good, the capex announcement, but we have to see how it will get implemented. So from the budget perspective, I think these are three good things which has happened. One, obviously there is no tax changes. Absolutely no tax change, which is a very good stable regime for the foreign investors, Indians, as well as, I mean, everybody. Second, this bringing more credibility to the budget in the form of getting those FCI and other borrowing on the union budget, that is a good thing. Thirdly, government kept promise with the spending, higher spending, and they are allocating it to capex or infrastructure. Apart from that, I think if you see in last 3 years or so, or since this government has come in, or since the actually the GST got implemented, budget is actually is not the only event or vehicle through which the decisions are taken. Lot of decisions are actually happening outside budget also. So if you see in last 1 year, the productivity link incentive scheme, which was adopted by the government or declared by the government for import substitution of in areas like mobile phones, laptops, TV, auto and everything, as well as export incentive. So this scheme earlier could have come into the budget, but now it got announced outside budget also. Even this farm laws, etc., they got announced outside of budget also. So I think lot of reforms are happening outside budget also, and to that extent, I think this reform process is continuing. So I think overall, if you look at all these things, budget along with this PLI and farmers, this farm act changes, etc., I think all these things are very good for the economy. So I think this positivity will continue. Lot of implementation is also happening, particularly in this PLI scheme, the productivity link incentive scheme. Lot of companies are getting awarded with the contract to set up manufacturing facilities, and they will be incentivized for that. So I think a lot of implementation is happening, and market is looking through, and I think that will all be positive for the market.
You can share the market outlook as well.
Yeah, so outside budget, and this was my narrative even earlier also, I think next year we are going to see very good growth because the base is low, and then there is pent up demand which is there in the system. Along with that, there is government spending. So we are going to see very good growth next year. And on top of that, As you know, inflation has make a comeback now. You know, the prices of steel, copper, aluminium, and many other commodities have gone up by 10 to 20%. So what happens during such type is times are basically you will get volume growth of 10 to 12% because of the recovery and the government thrust, and on top of that you will get maybe 5 to 10% pricing related growth. So next year the top line of the corporates are going to go up from anywhere between 12 to 15-18% because of this growth and inflation dynamics. And when this dynamics takes place, it is very very good for the equities as a asset class, as long as inflation remains under control. So I think we are in that very favorable or Goldilocks situation. Economics call this a Goldilocks situation. So we are going through that, or going, we will go through that. The second positive aspect of this growth and inflation is basically the government tax collection will also be good, because government collect taxes on nominal value of goods and services. And now, suppose last year anybody would have sold, say, steel of 100 rupees, this year you will sell 10% more volume, so it will become 110, and on top of that there is 20 rupees price increase, so the actual sales will be 130 rupees. So government will collect GST on this 130 rupees. So across industries this is taking place, and hence I think government taxes will also be good. And lastly, the banking sector credit growth will also be good because of the same growth and inflation dynamics. Today SBI reported numbers, and you would have read into the newspaper tomorrow that the bank is saying that from second quarter 22 they probably can see double digit credit growth, because again, any company which is having, say, 100 rupees stock, next year they will have 110 rupees stock, and on top of that, because of increase in commodity prices, the value of that stock will be 120-125, and they have to borrow more for that 125 rupees. So credit growth will also come back. So I think because of this thing, growth coming back strongly, and during this COVID year, lot of companies and corporates have tightened their cost structures massively. Traveling is not happening, and lot of other things are not happening. So cost structures are under tight control. So next year you will have better top line growth and in control cost structure. So the profit growth will be very good. So we are predicting as of now almost 35 to 40% EPS growth for Nifty in FY22. And mind you, even in FY21, which is a COVID year, in this year itself, we are getting a nominal growth in the EPS. So there are no losses or degrowth in Nifty EPS. Actually, even in this year, we are growing EPS. And on top of that, we are going to have 35-40% EPS growth next year. So from bottom up, this perspective is there that the growth will be very good. From top down, globally, if you look at the easy liquidity policy will continue, lower interest rate policy will continue for some time. The US Federal Reserve has given enough hints for that. And I think in this backdrop, market will do very good. From the top down view, lot of people complain about this liquidity, that their liquidity is driving prices and all those things. But I think it is kind of a new phenomena or fundamental. And the other way to look at it is basically money has been printed usually in last 6 months. Actually, it has been going on for last 10-12 years since the Lehman crisis. But in last 6-8 months, globally, there is some kind of excess about that. So there is ample money supply, and whatever is in ample supply, it loses its value. So we are seeing that the commodities or gold has gone up, equity, the share market has gone up. But the other way to look at it is basically money is losing its value, and we are interpreting it as the prices, asset prices are going up. So I think that will continue for some time. And lastly, we have to talk about valuation. It is actually the part of the second equation, that money is losing its value. So valuation, we have to look at from that angle, that there is excess liquidity, interest rates are zero to negative in for large part of the asset. And because of that, valuation will have support. Secondly, as we are seeing very good growth for next 2-3 years, I think this again, this growth, whenever growth comeback is there, market valuations will sustain. And lastly, if when we talk about the index or Nifty, actually, and compare with say 5 years back valuation or 10 year back valuation, we forget that the Nifty is going through a lot of changes. In last 3 to 4 year, companies like Yes Bank, HPCL, GAIL, etc., went out of index, and companies like Nestlé, HDFC Life, SBI Life, Britannia, these kind of companies entered the index. So the companies which went out had a PE of 10 to 12, and the companies which came into the index, they have PE of 50 to 60. And because of that, the weighted calculated PE of index is looking very high. So we have to do that adjustment. And looking all these things, I think valuations are reasonable even at these price levels, and hence market will sustain. There can be volatility, obviously, after such sharp rally of 10-15%, like we have seen just before budget, almost like 8-10% correction, and we came back in just 3-4 days. So we will see such kind of instances again and again. But overall, I will maintain my positive view on the market.
Okay, so going back to equities, as you had said, government has been late in meeting their targets of the budgets. We've seen some disinvestment targets as well in this budget. Do you think PSUs, which have been underperforming for 3-4 years, they can expect a revival post this?
First of all, the disinvestment target, I think, obviously, in this year or the year gone by, government couldn't meet the target because of there was COVID and all those things were happening. Next year, I think they can make maybe up to the 70-80% of the target can be achieved, because this year government tried to disinvest BPCL, but that couldn't happen. But there is a lot of progress has happened on that front, so possibly it can happen next year. And then there are other enterprises like Air India, which was in this process for last 2 years actually. So and there are also some progress has been made, so hopefully that will also happen. I would say to the extent of maybe 70-80%, government can achieve those targets. And in terms of how PSUs will do, I think very few PSUs can do well, because overall economy is going to recover. As I harp upon this growth and inflation dynamics, it will also help some of the banking PSUs, and also some of them are very, very cheaply valued, so they can do well, very well for some period of time. But this is not true for the entire PSU pack. I think very few of them can do well. The overall structure of the PSU management is not changing, and hence I think they will continue to underperform the market, barring 2-3 names.
Thank you, Atul. We've seen not much subsidy has been given to the most affected sectors by COVID, like hospitality, aviation, even real estate. By when do you think we can expect some revival? Because these sectors have been underperforming markets.
So I think it is very difficult for the government to give subsidies or any kind of benefit to such kind of sectors, because I mean, except aviation, there is a lot of organized, unorganized kind of element in these sectors. So I think these sectors will recover on their own whenever this vaccination drive is going on. So probably in next 3-6 months, large part of the population will get vaccinated, and anyway, the COVID fears or the COVID-related infections are falling. As and when the economy or government is actually opening up the economy one by one, so trains will start and all. So I think that time hospitality and aviation kind of will start doing well. I think real estate should start doing well, maybe next 6 months, 12 months, 18 months on its own, because real estate follows a typical cycle of, say, maybe whatever 8-10 years, and we have seen that 8-10 years gone by in terms of prices haven't gone anywhere. Incomes of people would have gone up by some percentage, maybe 50-100 in those 8 years, 10 years, and the interest rates are lower. So I think for real estate, the lowest interest rates is the biggest subsidy. I mean, if you are getting a home loan at 680, I think you don't need any subsidy for real estate sector. So I think you will observe that maybe in some cases, in most of the cases, the difference between rental and EMI would have shrunk a lot. And when such thing happen, people start buying homes. They will prefer buying home rather than paying the rent, because paying rent is an expenditure and paying EMI is like a systematic investment plan, SIP. It creates assets. So I think those decisions will happen, and already some state governments have given some benefits of stamp duty reduction and all. And in many markets, the inventory of real estate has got reduced a lot. And in last 3-5 years, there has not been any new launches in many markets, and the inventory is going off. So now very little inventory is there in many markets, and I think probably we are on the cusp of the new real estate cycle. It will take place in a different shape or fashion. Maybe the organized or the larger developers will do very well. Not all of them will recover. The sector will also go through a consolidation, is going through a consolidation. But I think, as I said, asset prices will do well because money is losing its value, and real estate is also, I think, is ready for that.
As you mentioned, Atul, there's a huge infra and capex push by the government. You mentioned that cement and steel sectors can do well. What are some of the other sectors you think that will directly or indirectly benefit from this?
Yeah, well, I think this is a good question. I think whenever government announced this kind of big capex plans and all, people obviously look at infrastructure company or construction companies, but hardly any money has been made into these infrastructure or construction companies, because announcement is one, but you know how the contracts are taken, work is executed, there are always delays in execution, and then they have to look at recovering that or getting that money from the department. So I think because of that, these companies' cash generation, ROE, never stacks up, and hence the stock prices are not able to do anything. But the best way to play this infrastructure spending, along with the housing recovery, which we are seeing and we will see, is basically government is spending a lot of money on affordable housing also. And it is as good or big as like infrastructure spending. This Prime Minister Affordable Awas Yojana is happening in a very big scale. And it is also as good as infrastructure spend. So I think the better way to play this infra and housing spend is basically cement. I think cement is a very good sector to play infrastructure spending and the housing related spending, because the cement industry is good. They don't have any cash issues. I mean, whatever they sell on cash. The industry is consolidated. They have pricing power. You know how the cement prices has gone up in last 1-2 years. So cement is one. Apart from that, I think the plastic pipe or the entire piping sector is very good, because government has announced this Nal Se Jal Yojana. So huge spending is happening there and will happen there. So plastic pipe, GI pipe, they will be required in this housing and infrastructure. Other materials like tiles, sanitary ware, even cables and wire, every infrastructure and housing project, cables and wire form 2-3% of that project. If there is a 500 crore metro construction is going on, almost 100-150 crore of cable and wires will be required. 10-15 crores of cable wires will be required. So I think these kind of building material companies, cement companies, etc., not because of this. I mean, the stock prices will benefit a lot because these sectors are organized, consolidated. These companies have managements are very good. So I think whenever there is infra and housing spend, we have to look at these sectors. Along with housing, as I mentioned, I'm positive on real estate, and a lot of work is happening on affordable housing. Housing finance companies will also should also do very well, I think, going forward.
Okay. I will just go on to my last question. As you said that money is losing its value, and we've seen that gold has performed exceptionally well in the last 1 year. In the budget, we've seen gold and silver duties have been dropped. How do you think gold as an asset class is going to look forward with the custom duty rule and with the new and with the increase in money supply now that money is losing some of its value?
Yeah, so as I mentioned in budget, they actually haven't done any changes. So they have reduced the customs duty on gold. But if you look at in detail, they have imposed an agri cess on gold imports. So virtually there is just, so the earlier import duty was 12.5%. They reduced the duty to 7.5%. But they impose a 2.5% agriculture cess on gold imports and silver imports. So effectively from 12.5%, the duty has come down to just 10%. So I don't think, 2.5% will make any difference in the prices because of that. On the whole, I think if you take a slightly long-term view of say 3 year, 5 year, I think gold should do well because see, gold does well in two instances. One, if there is inflation in the economy or globally, and second, if there are kind of a war or some geopolitical kind of uncertainty. So I think I'm not bothered about the second, but obviously because of this last 10 years of money printing, easy monetary policy and all those things, and as I mentioned, there is enough money supply. Obviously, inflation will make a comeback at some point of time. And we are seeing that in terms of commodities, like crude has also gone up from 40 to 60 now almost. Steel, copper, aluminium, etc. Maybe there are some supply chain issues and hence the prices has gone up. But there is some kind of genuine demand also. So as and when the inflation keeps going up, I think gold will also keep on doing well. And again, the point is there is so much money supply and etc. So I think over a period, gold should do well.
Thank you, Atul. That's all the questions from our end. I'd like to thank you for your time today. I think we've got a good understanding of all asset classes and your view in the medium term towards them. And even the important sectors mentioned in the budget. Thank you for your time.